Hi everyone. Well, first off, I want to apologize about the audio quality. I know it's not the greatest. Unfortunately, I'm using a backup set of headphones right now for this, so we'll keep them kind of short and quick, and that way we don't have to deal with too much of it. We'll be back to the normal headphones next week. I want to go ahead and walk you through the definition to do the signal box, and to do that we need to understand how a single gill works and then a field of gills. We're going to start with this file, and if you haven't yet, you can download this file under the Karman site. So here we have the Karman site. If you go to Files, the Attractor Points folder, and the SignalBox underscore gill is the file I have open right now. And that brings us to here. So this first video is a repeat of what we did in class. If you've already seen this, you can go ahead and skip to the second video. This is for those who may have missed or need a refreshment on what we did in class on Wednesday, May 17th. Here is the single gill, and we've got it laid out pretty simple. We have a curve here at the end, which we're calling curve B. We have a corresponding curve here, curve A. We find the midpoints of those, connect those with a line, which we're calling curve C. We then move curve A from the end to a middle location, like so. And we take that middle curve and then rotate it and scale it, and finally loft from curve A through that newly created curve into curve B to create our surface. To do that, what we need to do is need to go ahead and start a definition by referencing these two objects into Grasshopper. To do that, these are curves, so we're gonna go to parameters, geometry, and curve. I'm gonna call this curve A, and do a copy paste and curve B, and reference them both. Now, it's really important that you reference the one that is closer to the x-axis as curve A, so the one that's along this x-axis, curve A. And the other one can be set as curve B. So I'm gonna go ahead and right click, set one curve, and curve B like so. So the first thing you need to do is draw a line between those. And we know we're gonna do that underneath our curve, primitive, and line component. To do that though, we need points. We need a point to draw a line from and the point to draw a line to. Right now what we have are curves. So we have a curve A and a curve B. We need to find the midpoints of these two curves. To do that, we wanna take the curves and we wanna analyze them. We want to find a point on a curve. And what we get is this number slider looking thing. What this does is it performs a task called reparametizing, where the curve essentially is not thought of as a length or a distance, but a starting and an ending. And the start is 0, the end is 1, and the any value in between there is kind of like a percentage along the way. So if we set this to 50%, that's basically the midpoint of that curve. Now we can move it back and forth to any number, or we can right-click and set it to the start, the quarter, third, midpoint, or any of those along the way. So once I wire that in, you'll see the result of that is an actual point. Now I've gone ahead and should be able to see a point happening along the curve A object. Let's go ahead and I'm gonna reset, set one curve. There we go. Sorry, I had to reset that curve A for a moment. And now you'll see as I move the slider back and forth, it moves from the starting to the ending of that point, set to the middle. We're gonna copy paste and wire curve B into the other one, like so. And wire those into the A and B input of the line. There we are. Now what we need to do is we need to be able to find the midpoint of this newly constructed curve, because we need to move the end curve, which is curve A, from its current location or the current midpoint, the current end, to the midpoint of that curve. So to do that, again, we're going to curve analysis, point on curve, leave it at the 50%, wire that in, and there's now the midpoint of this span. So now we're going to go ahead and move curve A to that end location. Let's go to transform, Euclidean, and move. Geometry you want to move is curve A. So let's go ahead and wire in curve A as the geometry. Now the T is asking for a translation vector. We're going to go under our vector tab and vector panel, and there's a lot of different ways we can make vectors. The one that we want to use is a two-point vector. That's simply saying move it from a point to a point. The from a point will be its original midpoint. The to a point is the new curve C midpoint. So its original midpoint is the midpoint of curve A right there. That's going to be the A input. And the new location is the midpoint of that constructed curve C, which is that one right there. There we go. That gives us a vector because it says from a point to a point, there's a distance and a direction associated between those two points. Go ahead and move that. And now what we get is this curve has been moved and copied to this new midpoint. Perfect. Let's go ahead and start grouping some of the stuff together. I'm going to go ahead and group all this because this all has to do with referencing the curves, drawing the finite midpoints, and drawing lines between it. Now this is all about moving those points. So go ahead and group that. Now I move that curve A geometry to the middle. And now what I want to do is I want to go ahead and I want to rotate this. So if I go to transform, Euclidean, and rotate, there's a bunch of rotates. The one we want is an axis. The axis we're going to rotate about is actually this curve C object. So let's go ahead and drop in that rotate. The geometry I want to rotate is this moved version of the curve. So that's the moved version of the curve. That's the geometry. We're going to skip the angle for a moment and go to the axis to rotate about. The axis we want to rotate is curve C. Curve C is this line. In fact, I'm going to relabel that to say line curve C, like so. Okay. And I'm going to relabel this as midpoint of C. These are midpoint of A and midpoint of B, like so. So we're going to use the curve C as the axis to rotate about, like so. Now we need to do a set an angle to rotate. Now by default, you'll see it says that in this pop-up window, rotation angle in radians. We don't know radians very well, but we do know degrees. So if I right-click on the A input, I go to degrees, I get a little asterisk. So now I know I'm going to use degrees as the rotation angle. Now I can type in something like 1 degree, 2 degrees, so on and so on. From our assignment, we know that a positive and negative 90 degrees is our ideal rotation. So we're going to go parameters, input, number slider. We're going to go ahead and double click, change the title to rotation angle. Integers is fine because 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree, that's plenty of control. And the minimum value is going to be negative 90, so I'm going to scroll that down to negative 90. And the upper limit is positive 90, so I'm going to scroll up to positive 90, like so. Hit OK, wire that in. And now, as I rotate this, you'll see that I rotate the object along that C-axis. I still have a version of the old one because we never just destroy old data, so I'm going to go ahead and turn off this old information here. And there we go. Now the last step we want to do, and we're going to group that together as well, the last step we want to do is to scale this as well. Okay? So let's go underneath transform, Athene, and we want to use a basic scale. The geometry we want to scale is the rotated version of the moved curve. So the rotated version of the moved curve is the geometry. The center of scaling is going to be this point, okay? And that point is the midpoint of curve C. So here's curve C, here's the midpoint of curve C. That is the center of rotation, or scaling, excuse me. And scale factor can be anything, really. I would say we don't want to make it from half of its current length to twice its current length, so that would be 0.5 to 2. So underneath the number slider, we're going to go ahead and double click. I'm going to call this the scale factor. Okay. Maybe two decimal places. Lower limit would be 0.5, so scale to half its original size. Upper limit would be 2, twice its original size. Go ahead and wire that in. And we never destroy old data, so you've seen the old object kind of co-aligning with the new one. So just turn off the previous step. And there you go. There's the scaled version, like so. I'm going to go ahead and group that together. And the only other thing we have left to do then is to go ahead and loft all these together. So we're going to do a loft component. So we can go underneath our surface, go to freeform and loft. And we need to make sure we loft these in order. They're all going to go into the C input of our curve input, our C input for our loft. We want to start with curve A. So that's all the way at the beginning. Here's curve A. We want to start the loft there. Then we want to loft into this rotated version of the curve. That's going to be this very last version of the curve. So hold down shift, get the plus sign, and loft it through there. And there our loft has started. And we want to end with curve B. So again, we go to the very beginning, start to do it, hold down shift, and wire it into the C input. It's really important that you do them in the proper order. If you don't, I'm going to go ahead and disconnect all of these. If I just do A, hold down shift, do B, hold down shift, come back through the scaled version, you'll see it actually kind of doubles back on itself, okay, because that's not the proper order. Oftentimes what I see happen is students go ahead and go to wire a second one in and hopefully get to hold on shift, and it replaces the originals, and they're like, oh, whoops, and then they come back and then hold down shift. And, well, now you've wired the scale in first, the A in second, and now the B in third. Okay, so again, this to the second, back to the third. That's why lofting, it's really critical that you loft in the proper order. Okay, so we're going to disconnect, go back to doing A, hold down shift, the scaled version, hold down shift, and we do B. And there's the result. Okay, we're now able with these two sliders to be able to rotate that surface and scale that surface. In the next video, we'll go ahead and work on these couple surfaces off to the side here and go ahead and play around with breaking this up into multiple objects.